Hello everyone, wish you all a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays. I hope you are doing well and enjoying your holidays. Last week, I announced the launch of DAOYI's Discord server. Thank you to everyone that has joined the Discord already and has been engaging in discussions there. Before we get on with today's video, let me make a quick announcement related to DAOYI. We are currently in the process of planning an online magazine. We would like to know what content you would like us to include in the magazine. Please send us your suggestions in the feedback channel on the DAOYI Discord or send us an email to feedback@daoyi.org. If you prefer to remain anonymous, your engagement is support to DAOYI and to the wider community as well. I highly appreciate it. With that out of the way, let's get on with today's video. This is the 15th monthly Q&A video. Let's take a quick look at the questions for today. First, nominal, importance of Wu Zhenpian. Second, nominal, Daoist and Neigong. Third, from Bruno Nunes, Xingyi Weapon Practice. Fourth, from Frederick Gordon, Health Benefit of Bagua. Fifth, Thomas Hudacek, Preferred Method of Teaching New Movements. Sixth, from Justin Mongo, Qi Tiebei. Seventh, Lex Green 2009, Zhan Zhuang in Stormy Weather. Eight, Lover Boy, Fa Li Method in Xingyi Quan Lineage. Ninth, from Zhuang O'Trakun, Fa Li Exercise. Tenth, from Fred Talk, Refined Ancestral Energy and Postnatal Jing. 11th, from Shi Wan, Li Cunyi's Caravan Security Company. Nomino asks the importance of the Wu Zhenpian, written by Zhang Boduan around year 1000, regarding internal arts, Neigong, and Daoist philosophy. Thank you, Nomino. This is a great question. First, let me introduce Zhang Boduan. Zhang Boduan lived about 1000 years ago. He was the founder of Daojia Nanzong, or Southern Daoist School, and one of the most important figures in Xiudao practice. Like many other Daoist figures in history, he also was a well-trained scholar. He worked as the military advisor of the royal government for years before he realized that the most important purpose of his life was to pursue Daoist practice. Then he stopped everything that he had been working on and used the rest of his life to focus on practicing and teaching Xiudao. He lived for about 100 years, which is a very long life, even by modern standard, but especially more so back then. Wu Zhenpian of the Book of Understanding Reality was one of the Zhang Boduan's main book. This book is one of the only two books considered to be Dan Jing Wang, or the king of Xiudao classics in Daoist history. The other book titled Zhou Yi Can Tong Qi, or The Kingship of the Three, was written by Wei Boyang about 900 years before Zhang Boduan's time. Based on my research, I want to say that the indicator of the development of Xiudao is the publication of Zhang Boduan's Wu Zhenpian, or the Book of Understanding Reality, since this was the first book that emphasized and systematically introduced internal energy practice, or internal elixir practice. All of the Xiudao documents published prior to this book was not as clear and structured in terms of the practice. This book is considered a major milestone in the development of Xiu Dao. This is why I always say that in order to understand and master Xiu Dao, Wu Zhenpian is the must read. Think about it. There have been thousands of Daoist books written throughout history, and this book is one of the only two books considered worthy of the title King of the Xiu Dao Classics. Also, it is worth noting that there are more than 60 commentary books on Wu Zhenpian, which should give you an idea of its importance. The best one, in my opinion, is the Wu Zhen Zhi Zhi, or Direct Reference of Understanding Reality, written by Liu Yiming in the Qing Dynasty. About 20 years ago, a student of mine showed me an English version of the Wu Zhenpian, or Direct Reference of Understanding Reality, translated by Thomas Clary. I read a few chapters and realized that even though the Daoist terms used by Zhang Boduan and Liu Yiming were not well defined due to the nature of this type of book, at least there's a reference for this type of important Daoist document in English. Regarding practice, Zhang Boduan, as the founder of Daojia Nanzong, or Southern Daoist School, firstly described the practical approach of Xian Ming Hou Xing, or cultivate life prior to cultivate nature. If you would like to understand the meaning of the term life and nature in a Daoist context, please watch some of my prior Xiu Dao videos. Link of my Xiu Dao playlist is in the description. You may have heard that Daojia Beizong, Northern Daoist School created by Wang Chongyang. Actually, Zhang Boduan is about 100 years earlier than that. Zhang Boduan was the first person who introduced the concept of San Jiao Gui Yi, or three teachings including Daoist, Buddhism, and Confucianism, unify as one. His approach continues to influence Daoist practice even today. Also, I have to point out that Zhang Boduan was a Xiu Dao figure. Zhang Boduan's work has nothing to do with martial arts. However, anyone who practices martial arts can also practice internal energy refinement. It's simply infeasible to provide a good introduction about Zhang Boduan in a short Q&A video. I will find the chance to make a video introducing his practice in the future. Now, Mino, thank you for this great question. Let's move on to Mino's second question. Nomino asked a general cultural question. He said, quote, "Some time ago, I mentioned Qiu Chuji to a Chinese colleague, engineer level, and he asked back, the Kung Fu guy. Now that I'm slowly reading Liu Yiming, a cultural question came forth. Do all the Daoists know and practice a Nei Gong art?" This is an interesting topic worth talking about in this video. Qiu Shuji, one of the Bei Qi Zhen, or Northern Seven Immortals, was an important Daoist figure in history. Unfortunately, many people in China have only heard about his name in wuxia movie or wuxia novels. Wuxia can be literally translated to martial heroes. It is a term that became very popular a few decades ago, after some martial art fiction novels got published. By the way, I have never read a wuxia book, since I would feel so bad if I compare myself to those figures in wuxia novels, since I cannot fly or defeat someone from 10 meters away by energy. Qiu Chuji is very often a figure in those wuxia movies or novels. So many people in China know about his name through wuxia media. But in history, Qiu Shuji was a famous Daoist figure, and he wrote many books about Xiu Dao. You have to read his book if you practice Xiu Dao. By the way, an interesting fact about Qiu Shuji. He traveled 15,000 kilometers over a period 2+ years in his early 70s in order to meet Genghis Khan or Genghis Khan and convince him to stop his mass murders and adopt a Taoist approach. Regarding your question about whether Taoists know and practice Neigong art, well, it depends. A religious Taoist does not need to practice it, but a Taoist practitioner absolutely must. I know a lot of Taoist monks who do not practice any internal art at all. They just wear the Taoist uniform and pray. Hope that answers your question. Now, you know, let's move on to the next question. Bruno Nunes asked about Xing Yi's weapon practice, such as historical information if some Xing Yi weapons were used in real combat. He also said, we know the importance of a spear practice in Xing Yi power development, but I'm talking about self-defense. Hello, Bruno. This is a very good question. Since you use the term Xing Yi weapons, I have to limit my answers to Xing Yi. So, Xing Yi was the style created by Li Luoneng less than 200 years ago, which makes it a very new style compared to many other Chinese martial art styles. So, regarding Xing Yi's weapon used in real combat, I'd like to share two historical pieces of information. The first one is the Li Cun Yi. He used his customized Xing Yi saber not only as a weapon in his caravan bodyguard business, but he also used it to fight and killed many foreign invaders in Tianjin in military conflicts. The other pieces of evidence is that the Xing Yi saber was used by military soldiers for training during World War II in China for fighting against the Japanese army. I think these two are the best examples for the question, since I'm not talking about a random person using a staff to hit someone in the street and claim that they were using a Xing Yi weapon in combat. Now, let's talk about the spear. Well, the spear is my favorite weapon. When I was a child, I practiced not only the spear form, but also how to apply it. In Montreal, when I teach my students, I always teach them how to use it. However, in modern times, even though a spear is a great weapon, I do not think we have a chance to use it in a self-defense situation. Carrying a spear in public in Canada is illegal unless you carry a permit. Not to forget, it also looks weird to many people. Imagine this. A Chinese person holding a spear and walking on St. Catherine Street, a major commercial street in Montreal, must attract a lot of unnecessary attention, which I do not want to happen. It might give it a try for the next Halloween. So, spear training nowadays is mainly used for power training. Our living conditions have changed, and the spear has become a training device already. Bruno, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Frederick Gordon reminded me to talk about the health benefit of Bagua practice, since I said in a prior video that Bagua provide the best health benefit among the three internal styles. First of all, thank you, Frederick, for reminding me about this question. Let's talk about it today. Based on my observation, Bagua practice can provide two major benefits compared to the other two internal styles. First, Bagua practice focuses on walking. Especially, most of the Bagua style now use circle walking as their main practice. We all know that as we advance into old age, the first physical issue arises in walking. Some research done by Beijing Sport University indicates that 八卦 practice can improve stability, mobility, and flexibility, which is the key issue to senior citizens. Second, 八卦 practice emphasizes the turning motion of the bike. According to TCM, stimulation of the bike, especially the area beside the spine or the 背腧穴, which are acupuncture points along the spine, can provide a great health benefit since the organ's energy can be strengthened by stimulating those points. Also, this concept in TCM has been proven by modern medical research already. Of course, these benefits can be provided by practicing many other styles, but 八卦 practice really emphasizes this aspect and can provide comparatively more benefits. I can talk about this topic for a very long time, but in the interest of time, let's move on to the next topic. Mr. Tomasz Hodacek asks about my preferred method of teaching a new movement in terms of teaching order. Thank you, Mr. Hodacek. This is a great question related to teaching. When I teach, I use the following approach. First, show the whole movement to the students. Then break it down to different parts of the body movement. I will teach arm movement first, then leg, then body movement. Then I will teach them the complete movement in a slow motion. Then let students practice. Then teach it at a normal speed. Then talk about applications for each movement. And at the same time, mental work will be taught at the same time, since our mind follows our body movement in teaching. But in practice, mind guides the body movements. I'm sure you have your own method and experience. Please feel free to share your own approach in the comment section. I hope I have answered your question, Mr. Hodacek. Let's move on to the next question. Justin Munger asked a specific question about qi tie bei. I'd like to read his question first. On the next Q&A, can you talk about qi tie bei, the abdominal part below the umbilicus seem to adhere to the spine and the adhesion intensifies with the Tai Chi routine. Can you please discuss some specific techniques from Xiu Dao on how to work more on Qi Tie Bei or using Zhan Zhuang if possible? Great question. Thank you, Justin. To answer it better, I'd first like to talk about Qi Tie Bei, since I believe it's not a very well-known term in the community. So, what is Qi Tie Bei? Wu Yuxiang, the founder of Wu Hao Style Tai Chi, wrote an article titled Shi San Shi Xing Gong Xin Jie, or 13 Posture Practice Explanation. In that article, he said, quote, Qian Dong Wang Lai Qi Tie Bei, end quote. Translation, lead the movement forward and backward, and the energy stick to the bike. End translation. It is an interesting concept, and I will discuss this in a future video, but I'd like to briefly introduce it today. As for Qi Tie Bei, Qi means energy, Tie means stick, Bei means bike. Put together, it means the feeling of energy sticking to the bike. Again, a term without explanation in a martial art article can lead to many different types of explanations and unfortunately, many misinterpretations. That's why it merits discussion in a future video. However, in Xiu Dao practice, we should not apply this kind of concept, since this term is used in martial art, but not in internal energy refinement. In other words, a term used to describe the energy feeling in martial art practice is not suitable for Xiudao practice. As for 站桩, yes, 气贴背 can be applied. Some basic principles such as naturally sinking down the shoulders, relaxing the whole body, and paying attention to the subtle movements of the back can be a good starting point. Also, extending the elbows slightly outward and extending the upper back slightly back outward can be also help you experience a 气贴背 experience in practice. Justin, I hope that information is helpful. Let's move on to the next question. LX Green 2009 asks about restrictions to practice 站桩 during stormy weather. I have answered a similar question before. Simply speaking, it is not suggested to practice 站桩 during stormy weather outside. However, if you practice it indoors, then that will not be a problem at all. Hope that answers the question. Ice Green 2009. Let's look at the next question. Lover Boy asks whether all lineages of Xing Yi Quan use the same method for Fa Li, Fa Jin, since he has noticed some masters coil back when they perform Fa Li and others do not. This is a great question. I have to say that if you practice Xing Yi, you have to practice Fa Li, or at least you have to know how to practice Fa Li, or else your practice won't be considered Xing Yi practice at all. Yes, different schools use different training methods in Fa Li training, but the Fa Li result in the end should be the same. Power should be released naturally without any obvious preparation. If you see someone do it unnaturally, then that is an issue in practice. As for coiling the back before Fa Li, I'm not sure whom you are referring to, but if the coiling time is long, then that is not the right method. Coiling the back or not does not make a major difference, but the length of the time does. Again, Fa Li is necessary and should be done naturally. That's the standard. I hope this answer helps. Let's move on to the next one. John O. Tricon asks why there are so many different Fa Li exercises. If you can get it in one movement, isn't it pretty similar to get the feeling in other body structure? Also, is it better to start Fa Li practice with a weapon to get physical feedback from the weapon to let you know if you are doing it correctly? A very good question. Regarding the first question, different parts of the body need to be trained differently in developing Fa Li. There's no universal Fa Li exercise, but after mastering Fa Li, you can then release force from any body part at any time. So we should not confuse the result with the procedure. As for your second question, people practice Fa Li with bare hands first, then use weapons to strengthen the Fa Li effects. Bare hand Fa Li training is the main part of this process. I hope this answer helps. Let's move on to the next one. Fred Talks asks, is the refined ancestral energy akin to postnatal Jing being refined? If not, what is the distinction between both? Primordial energy or ancestral energy you are using here included refined postnatal or postmortal Jing, since primordial Jing, Qi, and Shen are all called primordial energy. So, postnatal or postmortal Jing being refined becomes part of the primordial energy after practice. I'm aware this will sound abstract to many people who are not familiar with the Xiudao terms, but dealing with abstractions is an unavoidable part of Xiudao practice. Hope that answers the question, Fred. Let's move on to the final question for today. she once asked a question on the Daoist Discord about Li Cunyi's caravan security company, such as its role that the martial art played, particularly Xing Yiquan. She went, "Thank you for this interesting question. My grandfather worked at Li Cunyi's caravan security company. When I was a child, he talked about it with his friends very often. So I have heard about it many times. Basically, caravan security business was a very popular one for martial artists in the old days. Li Cunyi had a security company named Wan Tong Biao Ju or Wan Tong Caravan Security Company. Wan means 10,000, Tong means travel or approach or smooth. Caravan security companies played a very important role in the old time of China, since people had to hire them with a very high fee to protect their merchants crossing different regions. Before getting into the caravan security business, Li Cunyi used to work for the Qing government. Then around 1891, he opened his caravan security company in Hebei. After he moved to Tianjin, his business expanded from Hebei to Tianjin as well. After he opened the Zhonghua Wuzhihui, a Chinese martial artist association in 1911 in Tianjin, he could not keep operating his caravan business as before. However, his students kept operating it for him until the 1920s. Xing Yi was the main martial art taught and used in that company. Shi Wan, I hope that answers your question. So, that brings us to the end of this month's Q&A. A quick reminder to send us your suggestions regarding content for the Dao Yi magazine, newsletter, and blog, either via Discord or Dao Yi's feedback email. Thank you for watching. See you next time. Enjoy your holidays as well as your practice.